What's up, everyone? It's Sam here, back again for the Laurel Lounge. I just wanted to start out by saying thank you to all the subscribers out there and everyone that watched the videos. It's really great to see the channel growing so fast and people really seeming to enjoy the content. Next, I definitely want to thank everyone who watched and commented on our last video, the Gary Faden incident. Honestly, that was a big surprise to see how many people were actually interested in the story, so that was really cool to see. It does suck, though, that a few hours after it was uploaded, YouTube age-restricted and then privated the video for some unknown reason, so I'm trying to get that back up, and I'll be reposting it as soon as possible. Now, the interest shown for that Gary Faden video really made me want to make this video because it was another justified self-defense shooting that I found while researching that incident. This incident is commonly referred to as the high-volume shootout, the Harry Beckwith Incident. The information presented here also comes from an article written by Musad Ayoub for American Handgunner in October of 1995, so I'll link that article and any other resources I find in the description below. And so right now, why don't you just sit back, relax, and let's just dig into this thing. The night of November 12, 1990 promised to be a quiet one for the gun shop owner, Harry Beckwith. The regular bowling pin shoot had finished up less than an hour ago, and the gun shop was securely locked up, and so were the separate indoor shooting range buildings located behind it. Now, Harry was at home with his wife in their beautiful hacienda, separated from the business structures by about 100 yards of beach and sand, the picturesque setting that would have been a quintessential Florida postcard. Harry was relaxing, watching TV, and it was about 9:50 p.m. Suddenly, two sounds pierced the night. One was a distinctive crash of a heavy vehicle being driven through the steel-reinforced glass door, and the other was a yelping of a burglar alarm. Now, Beckwith moved instantly. He knew his rural location was remote. Even though the police would be rolling immediately, he wasn't sure that they can get here in time. He moved smoothly and certainly with the economy of motion that comes with age and with planning. And he knew his wife would get on the phone and put a gun in her own hand and find herself in a safe place. So that left his mind free to cope with the problem of dealing with the marauders. Now Harry reached for the weapons that he had laid out for just such a contingency. Now Harry had actually been involved in two other shootings in his life. The first was a pure pistol fight, which Harry drew and shot the thief, who surrendered immediately. And the second was in 1976, when Harry interrupted a felon midway through burglarizing his gun shop. That bandit raised a .45 auto pistol at Harry, who then let loose with a burst of 9mm hollow points from a Smith Wesson Model 76 9mm machine gun. A round actually struck the gunman in the head, but to Harry's surprise, the bandit was actually able to flee from the scene on foot. He was apprehended a short time later with a nasty head wound. Long story short, Harry had pretty much been waiting for this day to come. First thing Harry grabbed was his Charter Arms Bulldog revolver in an old cross-draw paddle holster. It slipped easily in place in front of his left hip. It was loaded with 5 rounds of his favorite .44 special ammunition, Winchester's silver-tipped hollow points. Next came his Model 76 submachine gun. One magazine was in place, bolt properly closed, condition 3. More magazines were rubber banded onto the extended stock. Now, Beckwith had found this to be a faster and easier way to access them instead of attaching a pouch to the same place. He slung the licensed submachine gun over his right shoulder. He then went and picked up his AR-15, a gun he'd always described as a Colt sporting rifle. It contained one magazine, downloaded to only 15 rounds. Another such magazine was banded to the plastic stock as well. With the other hand, he scooped up a Remington Model 1100 12-gauge semi-automatic shotgun, already fully loaded. Figuring he was ready for anything, Harry Beckwith quietly stepped out into the shadows, moving away from the house in the direction of the shop, some 100 paces distant. He could see now that the two vehicles were both 88 model Oldsmobiles, one blue, one white. Numerous adult male figures were scurrying in and out of the shop, bearing armloads of guns to the cars through the door they'd crashed through. He couldn't make out color or age, only that they were grown men and that there were maybe about 7 of them. At that point, between the shop and the house, he carefully laid out the shotgun down out of sight. It would be a fallback weapon if he had to retreat in that direction. He took the AR-15 in both hands, ready, and moved forward again. But there was a full moon out, and the same moonlight that allowed him to observe the criminals allowed them to see him. He knew he'd been made. "I should have been more in the shadows," Beckwith would tell years later. "He gunned the car straight at me. I'm too old to run, so I fired off the shoulder at him and the vehicle." When the butt of the rifle hit his shoulder, Beckwith opened fire, manipulating the trigger as fast as he could. Suddenly, the AR was not responding because it ran dry. The vehicle was still coming at him, rapidly closing to 50 yards distance. A skilled man can reload an AR-15 as quickly as a Colt 45 auto, and Harry Beckwith is definitely skilled at arms. His right index finger punched the mag release, his left hand broke the spare mag free of the rubber band, and slammed it home with a practiced motion, his left thumb simultaneously pressing the bolt drop paddle on the left side of the frame. He resumed fire as fast as he could work the gun. The high-pitched crack of the AR-15 could not drown out the dull sound of the .223 ball rounds punching through the auto body, nor the distinctive sound of heavy glass breaking. The vehicle swerved off course and Harry's gun ran dry. As he dropped the now useless rifle, the blue Oldsmobile veered away from him, cutting off to his left. It threw a giant rooster tail of dust as the driver accelerated away from the old man that seconds before he just tried to crush to death. Harry watched as the car disappeared onto Route 441. Now Beckwith turns his attention back to the shop. Five more of the burglars were there, mostly holding guns, pistols, and longer weapons. Silhouetted in the moonlight, too old to run, still facing 5-1 odds against men with all kinds of guns capable of easily killing him from 50 yards away, and who could have easily loaded up in some of the thousands of rounds that they had access to for some time now, Beckwith knew that he was still in danger. Harry swung up the Smith & Wesson submachine gun, racked the open bolt back, and cut loose on full automatic. I fired high over their heads to try and keep them down, he would later explain. I used short bursts. He saw them duck. He knew it had bought him a moment, but his near-death experience with the blue Oldsmobile bearing down on him was still fresh in his mind. If they crawled up to the covered side of the car, they could do the same with the white Olds. And if two magazines of .223 hadn't disabled the identical vehicle, what could he hope to do with 9mm fire? He realized that the time to disable the felon's second car was now. He swept it from one end to the other, reloaded, and continued. Every window in the Oldsmobile disintegrated as the copper-jacketed bullets tore through them. Beckwith had stagger-loaded the magazines with hardball and Remington 115 grain jacketed hollow points. The tires deflated with an audible hiss. Beckwith saw the surviving perps move away from the vehicle. Now the big danger was just being shot instead of being run down. A second empty Smith & Wesson magazine hit the ground, and Beckwith opened up with another burst of diversionary fire with a third stick. At this point, the perpetrators had had enough. He saw them run around the corner of the building, and then he took a cover position and waited. The first police car pulled into the scene approximately 1 minute later. To Beckwith, it seemed as if he'd waited an hour. However, reconstruction of the incident showed that it had been only 3 minutes from when the alarm sounded to when the first responding, I know I'm going to butcher this, Allakoocha County deputies made it to the gun shop. The incident itself had lasted less than 2 minutes. During that time, Harry had fired 105 rounds. By 2 a.m., all surviving perpetrators had been arrested or were in custody. Six were at the jail, one was at the morgue. Robert Patterson, age 18, was found dead in the wreck of a shot-up Oldsmobile. He'd gotten across the line into Marion County with one tire shot away, driving 13 miles before he'd lost control and crashed. Cause of death was a .223 rifle round through the chest. The second man in the blue car was captured near the scene. Both cars had been hot-wired and stolen. Some 20 stolen firearms were found in each car. The white Olds had been so badly shot up it had been towed from the scene. Patterson was the only one that was hit. This was because he was the only one Beckwith fired at. Most of the shots had been directed at keeping the other men's heads down and dissuading them, and also disabling the second vehicle. Goals he achieved with spectacular success. As Beckwith later described, I could have killed all five of them at the end when they were running away and exposed to me. But I was no longer in danger from them, so I chose not to shoot them. He had high praise and professionalism for the Allakoocha County Sheriff's deputies in general, and particularly for those that responded that night, with one possible exception. There is still anger in his voice when he relates that one of them wanted to read me my rights. However, the anger fades when he continues, and then a sergeant said to the guy, he's the victim for Christ's sakes. He is still bitter about having to speak before a grand jury. Most Florida jurisdictions bring justifiable homicides before a grand jury as a matter of course, but being there alone without legal counsel still has that star chamber feel to it and leaves you with no warm and fuzzies about the experience at all, obviously. As any high school civic student knows, the function of a grand jury is to determine if you've committed a crime, and that's a bitter pill to swallow when someone has just ripped you off and tried to run you down like a possum on the road. Harry Beckwith still bitterly refers to his cross-examination before the grand jury as an inquisition. However, the system generally works, and the grand jury returned a verdict of no true bill, in effect designated the incident as a justifiable use of lethal force. What leaves Harry Beckwith most unhappy today is that these perpetrators, initially charged with felony murder, were allowed to plead down to attempted burglary. They turned out to range in age from 16 to 21. Harry Beckwith fired two magazines of 15 round each from his Colt .223 rifle, and two full mags, and part of a third, from the Smith & Wesson submachine gun. Only one bullet caused death. The great majority of his gunfire fell into the quote-unquote warning shot category, suppressive fire if you will. We can argue at length about the concept of a warning shot, but the fact remains that in this case, it fulfilled its intended purpose. It was not lost to the grand jury that exculpated Harry Beckwith that he could have killed all seven perpetrators, but he chose not to. It was likewise to his benefit that twice before in his life, he had shown mercy and not killed the men he shot when they gave up the fight after he had wounded them. Now, every case that I've seen that has a shooting with a lawfully owned Class 3 weapon has gone to a grand jury. Now, some of those grand juries have indicted as well. However, every time that it was provably self-defense, the subsequent peanut jury has also acquitted the shooter. Still, such trials are extremely expensive for the defendant. And interestingly, Florida is one of those two states, the other being Washington State, where the accused citizen that's found not guilty at trial can be reimbursed legal fees and costs by the local government. So a good rule of thumb for avoiding trial in a justifiable shooting would be semi-auto yes, full auto no. In the November of 1990 incident, Beckwith fired more rounds than any armed citizen has probably fired in legitimate self-defense since the Indian Wars. So I'm glad that he got out of it okay. And I know that gun control and, you know, use of self-defense, that's all a very hot topic. But here we're just talking about the incident itself. Although in the comments, I would love to hear what you think. I'd love to hear about the prior incidents. And then would you have done what Harry did in this situation? Would you have just hid, let them take the guns, let insurance handle it? Would you fight it out? Would this depend on where you live, what country you live? And so give me your thoughts. I just want to know in the comments. And if you like the video and you like the content, make sure to hit that like button, subscribe, turn on those notifications. So just in case this video gets taken down like the last one or any of our content, you can always catch it before it goes down. Also, you can check out our other social medias, our Instagram, Twitter, and especially the SoundCloud, because we'll always put the audio files of all the videos up on the SoundCloud. So at least you'll get that. And that's really good to listen to in the car or doing chores around the house. That's what I love to do when I'm listening to lore. So thanks again for joining us here at the Lore Lounge. And until next time, bye for now. Thank you.